Ciao Toscani, thank you for doing the interview. This is a second try because we had a technical issue before. And as I said, the first question I want to talk about is the how when you showed up in Benetton, then Benetton revenue went up and when
that happened. I told you I was that happened in every company I used to work.
You know,
the funny thing at Benetton is that the company went up despite all the managers were against what I was doing.
Yeah.
The only person who believed what I was doing was the right thing to do was Luciano Benetton.
Yeah.
But all marketing people, all those advertising people, they were against what I was doing.
Yeah.
It's always like that. Anytime you do something very interesting, you got the all official establishment against you.
Yeah.
Always.
Yeah.
So it's very difficult because you know you know what you are doing is the right thing, but you're never really sure what you do, especially if you do something new in a new way, you cannot be sure.
Yeah.
No, you're sure just if you do things that you've already done.
Huh.
But if you do experiment, you cannot be sure. You have to have the courage not to be sure.
Yeah. Well, I wanted to compare you to Steve Jobs because usually Steve Jobs is the people, you know, like everybody knows Steve Jobs is the person who, when he was there, everything went up. They got rid of him, everything went down. He came back, everything went up. So I like this very simple proof that one person with their craziness.
Yeah, but Steve Jobs had the whole management against him. He got even fired.
Yeah.
I mean, the Benetton people, they would have loved to fire me, but they couldn't because Luciano Benetton, who is the owner, is not the manager.
Yeah.
Who is the owner, say, no, what he's doing probably is he could be very important. And that's how it happened. Yeah. But it's not just Benetton who, that happened. I also made the image of a company at the time was called Esprit, who also became very popular. Before Benetton, became very popular, and I was working with the owner, the name was Douglas Tompkins. And the same thing happened with Robert DiCaprio with Jesus Jean.
Yeah.
I tried all the time to do something that experiment, let's call it experiment.
Yeah.
In the world of communication, that's the only interesting thing to do, experiment. Otherwise, you have to follow the path that somebody else has planned. You know, marketing office, creative director. It's all bullshitter. Creative director, what that mean?
Yeah.
There isn't such a thing as a creative director. There is a creative person.
Yeah.
That is doing something interesting, but you cannot direct creativity. Impossible to direct creativity.
Yeah.
You can also push creativity if there is some creativity.
Yeah.
But you can't create creativity.
Well, what I noticed is that you take enormous risk. Like you really take, and you and Luciano took a lot of risk. And I think a lot of brands.
Risk of what? What? Well, being as you are or doing something new. What kind of risk?
It's not only new. You were doing controversial things, which are I like them a lot. I appreciate them a lot, but I think most people get very upset with those things. And like the death row,
controversial of what?
No, the way, just
controversial of what?
I'm wearing your shirt.
What is controversial? Controversial means that you are the worst thing for creativity is politically correct.
Yeah.
If you are politically correct, you cannot be creative.
No.
So.
Well, that's.
I don't think there is any risk. What kind of risk?
Well, what I'm saying is that let's look at the opposite. What other people are doing is they're waiting for something to be 100% safe. Everybody agrees, and then they pretend they figured it out. While you were doing it before that people agree with that. You were pushing it. You were the first one, you and Luciano, and then in your other campaigns. So that's what I mean. There is a risk always of people saying no. And the proof that you had trouble that's proof that you are taking this risk. And I'm interested where the ideas for this risk come from, because you're not, you know, you're not thinking about commercial, you're thinking about the bigger change all the time. This is what impresses me in your work. I can see that there is always a motivation far beyond just selling a shirt or something. Yeah.
Well, I realized that the world of communication and advertising is very conservative.
Yeah.
Everybody is doing the same thing. There are some rules that has been planned and everybody follow that. But I don't think it's a risk to do another road, you know? First of all, I'm not an advertising person. I don't come from the world of marketing. Actually, I find the world of marketing, the mentality of marketing, the wrongest thing for the economy.
Yeah.
The world of marketing is just conforming to all the rules, to the system. They don't invent anything. They look backward all the time. They don't look forward. They don't understand the future. They haven't got any mentality for innovation or reforming. They can't even consider that. So I thought, why that? So it wasn't that difficult for me to take a different path, to take a different direction. Actually, I was very curious to listen to those marketing meeting. And at the end of the meeting, I would say, well, you know what? I just do the opposite. So simple. No, it's true, because you know, everybody has to walk that way, and everybody walk that way, and you just walk the other side.
Yeah.
Everybody will notice you. Everybody will notice you.
No.
Just as a principle. You don't have to be a genius to understand, to,
yeah.
You know, you don't conform, you are different. That's so simple. If you don't conform, you are different.
Yeah, but
so if you don't conform in the world of advertising, what kind of risk is that? You don't go to jail, they don't kill you, you don't get poor. I don't know, what the hell? What's the problem?
Yeah, yeah. But let's say you said an interesting thing. So you go to a meeting and you have these money people, marketing people, whatever they are saying one thing. They have their own idea, they're saying one thing. But you choose the opposite. But you probably have an idea what is the opposite thing that you're choosing. Because, I mean, when I look at all your work, there is always, I see, maybe I'm projecting my own idea, but I think you always have an idea of the opposite that you choose. I mean, you're always choosing a specific thing, which is more compassionate.
Well, of course.
It's much bigger picture. I mean, when we met for 1 hour last year, and I asked you, what is your favorite artwork? And you told me The Bricklayer by August Sandera. I haven't seen that photo before, but you spoke about human condition. I don't know if you remember, and you said an interesting thing that there is art for the rich and obviously art that is not for the rich. And that kind of like stuck in my mind for a year. I mean, for you it was a conversation while you were eating a sandwich, you know, quickly with a guy. But, you know, I'm just thinking that that other path you choose is not only to be opposite of this, but there is some idea.
Of course, it's a combination. I got my own idea, my own morality, my own ethics, and my own vision, and my own aesthetics. You know, I got an education pretty strong, you know, about that. And I'm not just doing the opposite just because I find it funny. I think that I can express my conviction, even aesthetical conviction, by not conforming what the market is telling me to do.
Yeah.
I can express myself much better by going on another way, on a different way.
Yeah.
So if you feel that urge to go another way, you should have the courage to do it. Yeah. While I see that everybody conform, they go with the stream because it's easier. You know, you don't you get paid like that. I don't know what they. They are afraid to starve. I don't know what the lack of courage.
Yeah, yeah. But what is your main vision? What is, like, if you put one word over your, or sentence over your work, you know, what did you try to do? What do you try to change? What do you try to make?
I don't want to try to change, not nothing. I don't try not to change myself.
Yeah.
I try to follow what I'm able to do and what is my conviction. Mm-hmm. I'm a total situationist. I've got no ideas. I'm a witness of what is surrounding me, from this computer. Everything is surrounding me.
Mm-hmm.
What is surrounding me? The world is surrounding me with all these activities, vetoes, taboos, wars and peace and politics and relation and gender. And, you know, there's so much that you feel around you going on, and you are a judge. And I am a situationist. I pick the situation which is troubling me more, or this disturbing me most, or it is make me laugh most. I don't know. You know, there is always a situation that when you look from your balcony, like looking around the street, you know, you look what's going on in the square, in the square of the time you're living. I'm a witness of my time.
Okay.
So I pick the subject that I think they are ridiculous, stupid, nonsense, I don't know what, or violent, or unreceivable, you know? There are so much things that I hate, you know, like, I don't know, death penalty, you know? I did the thing against that because it's always disturbed me that there is such a thing in the world. That's how it's simple. So simple.
Yeah.
I mean, consuming, producing and consuming, there are two major activities of humanity, okay? Producing mean working, thinking, creating, and consuming mean culture. When you read, you consume, right? Already, yeah. There. So this, the relation between producing and consuming is very important in the evolution of civilization, you know? And so there is where the whole communication, advertising communication works, you know, about production and consumption. So you have to analyze where you stand there, where, what kind of criticism have you got to do? And so that's what I did. That's what I did. And that's what I still do.
Yeah. Well, but you met other people who feel the same way with whom you worked. Like you mentioned, I don't know how it was in Fiorucci. I remember Fiorucci. I used to go to their shop in Milan. It was like the most, you know.
Well, Elio understood when I was talking like that. He understood me and he support me, you know, like Luciano Benetton. Actually, they probably don't think like that, but they appreciate my thinking and they let me do what I thought I had to do. That's how it is.
And did you meet a lot of people like that? Do you seek them or it just happens? I mean, obviously you're well known now, you're notable and people know, and it's like a magnet, I guess. And I was lucky also that I meet people who think the same, kind of the same
way. They think the same, but they don't do the same.
Yeah.
They think the same, but they don't proceed like that. They
need someone else to do it with them.
Well, the world economy is the most important subject all the time. You know, if you think of something eccentric, they tell you it won't work economically. It's not true. I don't think it's true. No, I think big fortune are made by people who thought in a very eccentric way. Big fortune are made by people who don't think economy. They think of ideas, probably nonsense ideas, making incredible fortune. So I don't believe in the economy like that.
Yeah,
I think economy is. You know, if you want to become rich, you might become rich, but not really rich. Really rich, you become if you really think in a different way.
Yeah.
In a different way. You know, you don't think normally. You think much more eccentric than that. So this is the thing. I tell you, at Benetton, they couldn't stand me. Ah, all the manager, they wanted to get rid of me as soon as possible because they couldn't manage me. You know, when you are out of law, you produce problems, you know, to the people.
Yeah. Well, you're describing every situation I had in every company, I think, including mine, you know. So I think I got nails in my tires when I was working in Benetton, but it's a very tough crowd over there.
Very boring, very boring people.
Yeah, very tough. Yeah. But, you know, what I'm interested, like, but, you know, this crazy thing that you know, I see you as working with Luciano, and I never met Luciano.
No, I never, I did work for Luciano.
Yeah.
Luciano never worked with me.
Yeah.
He just gave me, he told me, okay, go ahead. Mm-hmm. Sometimes he didn't even see what I was doing.
Ah, okay. I always had this romantic idea that you are very much together.
Yeah, very much together, but talking like we are doing now.
Yeah.
About principle, about things, but he never really interfered practically in my work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, that's great. I mean, hands off, you know.
Of course, he doesn't know how to do it, as I don't know what to do in his work.
Yeah. Yeah.
He was responsible for the company and I was responsible for the image.
Okay.
It was the total trust.
Okay. So what pisses you? I mean, you described that you have these impulses, that you see that you're in situations and you have this impulse and something pisses you off or something motivates you. So what's motivating you now? What's touching you now? I mean, obviously, this is like the most bizarre situation.
Well, it's not that I'm normal and then I got a motivation. Yeah. Yeah, you know, everybody say, well, you had carte blanche. You were free to do what you're free. What do you mean you're free? I wasn't free. Nobody's free. Mm-hmm. Free for what? I had to do a job. I had to solve a problem. I had to make I had to make an image that everybody has to talk about. That's not free at all. So you have to come up with something special, something interesting, something people say shocking. What is shocking? Such a stupid word. Shocking. Word.
Yeah, that always annoys me. Whenever I talk to people about your work, they talk about
you don't
shocking.
Get shocked just because you see a poster. What the hell?
Yeah.
What the hell?
I'm glad you said
shock
that.
Shock advertising, what the hell? That's stupid. You know, this is the measure. That's the right measurement how stupid marketing is. Mm-hmm. Shock advertising, what the hell?
Yeah.
There is such a thing. Look, I can make you an example. You're watching TV, the news. Suddenly, the speaker of the news, the girl, the woman, presents herself upside down, head down, you know? Instead of talking like that, head down. With the hair down like that and say, now, 1 hour ago, the Third World War started. What shocked you more? The fact that she's upside down? On the news.
That I'm watching TV. I don't watch TV.
No, but you understand.
No, I know. I get the point. It's a good point. Yeah.
So, why she has to say that upside down?
Yeah.
A war is going on. But the fact that she's upside down takes you more than the war.
Yeah.
So but that's how the humanity is made.
What pisses you off now? Like in quarantine with Corona today, what do you think? Where is your thinking? If you could do a Benetton campaign,
terrible, because when I'm obliged not to travel, not to move around, it's very difficult to do my job. I find it very sad. I feel like I'm not, my voluntary to do anything is gone. I don't do nothing. I just look and think. Even reading, you know, after two pages, I notice I'm thinking of something else. I don't follow what I read. My head is somewhere else now. I never lived something like that before. I take it as an incredible experience. That's how it is. I try to put it as an experience, like being in jail. Like being in jail, exactly. We are not even in jail. We are exactly like those immigrants on the boat. But the immigrant on the boat, they're hoping to land to Europe, okay, coming from Africa. They got a task, they got something to do. They even risk their life for that. They're lucky. We are on the boat, but we don't know where we are ending.
Yeah, just standing in the middle.
We are on the boat floating in the nowhere. The other day, I was looking at the news and I saw those immigrants from Honduras who want to try to go to the United States through the border of Nicaragua. And there was the police trying to stop them. And they were holding their children, their thing. And, you know, I had a kind of envy not to be one of them. You know, to have such an incredible thing to do. They want to go to the United States to live a new life and to make it incredible, lucky. We are the opposite.
Yeah.
We are really fucked up. Yeah. Totally fucked up.
And, well, if you would do a Benetton campaign now, like that style of campaign, what would you do?
Well, depends. First of all, what kind of media today? This is a big thing. What, all social?
Just like you did the immigrant boat. You know, when I saw the immigrant boat, when you came back to Benetton, I was very happy. You know, that was a big thing, you know.
Yeah, then started the whole trouble with the bridge and the thing and the autostrade. Yeah. Bullshit.
Yeah. That same one photo, also the
now, photo. Now the big problem is the social communication through the social. The big problem is the difference between rich and poor. That's what is going to explode sooner or later. There is a discrepancy in the society that we can't go on like that. And in a way, the vertical fall of economy, the vertical fall of economy might be very positive.
You know, how would you show that?
Well, I don't know how to show. I start to think. I don't show. I know. I don't start thinking what I show. I start to think my own evolution, you know, and then at the end I will come to images or I don't know what, but I got my way to proceed that I don't start because I have to do an image. I don't have to do anything. I'm a human being living in this moment, in this world, and I do my thinking. That's it. That's my way of proceeding.
Yeah. So let's say you're a rich person, you know, and I'm a rich person. I mean, not as rich as you, but we are rich. you know, I think compared to what you're referring to, the people that are, I think, especially struck now with pandemic. So what should we do? What can we do?
I think that we are lazy. Already thinking we are lazy means that we don't do.
No.
We are basically lazy.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
Because what I'm worried about is that, okay, we say, okay, I'm rich, I'm more blessed, I have more luck, whatever, than others. And I understand others are in trouble, so let me do something. But we end up doing something that we like to do. We end up in a project or something fun. We don't really make a, you know, we don't make.
But too much what do you want to do? I'm rich. I live in a place. I got a farm.
Yeah. No, just talking in theory.
Very costly.
Yeah.
You know, I did plant. I think 40,000 trees on my land here.
Yeah.
I did do that. I got a piece of land which is a result of my work.
Yeah.
But I keep paying for this land. I did all what I do goes on the land. Yeah. I'm not making speculation in the bank. I never bought anything like that.
Yeah. I mean. Just to be clear, this is not a judgment. I'm saying in general because I believe that your work made a lot of change, much more than money. You know, so that's what I think. You know, and I'm just questioning laterally. You know, going around because I think you know what can a person do? Because I think your photography.
No, you have to be honest. You have to be honest. You know, when you are speculating on other people. You have to be honest. You have to proceed honestly.
Because if you're weak, if you don't have the resources, if you don't have the power, then you cannot make the change. To gain power, you need to be, you know, rich, successful, etc. It's a circle.
Well, I think that you have to have some quantity of subversive mentality. That's what it is. But there aren't so many people who do that. And probably when you get together a group of people of subversive mentality, then you start to produce things which are different. And by doing things who are different, the whole society slowly change. That's how it is. You need to, you know, I don't think that once it was better. I never think so. I think that society in the world is not civilized yet. We are not civilized. That's how it is. We're not civilized. And we are proceeding slowly into a more civilized world. Look at the Serbia, look at the in the 90s, what happened in your country. I mean, is that incredible, no? Civil war. Croatian, Serbian thing, hate, you know, this is not civilization, no? It is better now? I think it is a little better.
Always ready to explode.
You know, you young people understand what the hell our parents did. They're idiots.
Mm.
A bunch of idiots, totally. What to do what? What was the gain of that? No? Something idiot, totally nonsense. And we go on like that. And we once we used to go around with sword and guns hanging on our side, killing each other. As soon as we met, we kill each other. Now it's a little better, a little better. It is.
Yeah.
No? So I think we have to proceed like that. We're not civilized. We are not civilized.
Yeah. Well, what I was just thinking, because in the start I asked you about the main idea and about your work. And I see that, I mean, the problem, the way I see it, the problem that with a lot of what you call marketing and stuff going on there is that they're always trying to exploit an emotion like they did in Serbia with the wars. They try to exploit negative emotion. And every time I look at your work, I mean, it's always talking about, it's always trying to exploit one single emotion, because that's the trigger, is the compassion. That's how I see it. I mean, if I look at 100 of your photos, they're always about compassion. That's what I feel. I think that's the thing that you did really, that's really amazing, you know, because it's always, you're trying to do what all the people are trying to do, to exploit an emotion, but you choose a positive emotion to maximize it.
Well, there are, I don't know if it is positive or not, there are two subjects which are the main subject on which we based everything. Sex and death. Sex and death. That's it. Sex mean not physical, mean life, be born, be here, be alive. And death mean the opposite. Means that everything is going to finish and we are condemned to that. But nobody talk about that.
Well, you are now. Thank you for reminding me.
But we got that problem.
Yeah.
About sex and death. And so that's the subject that interests me. So you can go and tackle into that subject in many different ways.
But at least you choose the most positive side, which is what I think it's missing a lot, because there is so much of this content, you know, being shoved. I have three kids. They are 6, 10 and 15 years old, and they're always on the screens, of course, like all the kids. We don't have television, but they have Instagram and all this stuff. And they're constantly bombarded by content, which is designed to get them to feel something, you know. So just like you said, the war in Serbia was started by TV exploiting the paranoia about different people, you know, this nationalism and this shit. And then, and you're the only one that I know, I mean, there is not many, that was able to combine this huge business machine with really the most positive emotions, you know, to feel compassion, to feel positive. So I don't think it's so much about sex and death, you know, the Freudian psychoanalysis thing. I think it's more about that you really want people to be more compassionate, you know. And
well, if I see today, you ask me what is the problem today. I think that young people getting so dependent from social, from telephone, all those things, they're going to form a total irrelevant society in the future. They will be just consumer, nothing else. Yeah. They won't be deciding nothing.
Yeah.
Everything is decided by somebody else.
Yeah.
The few people who are not going to be dependent of technology, they're going to rule through technology.
Yeah.
It's going to be an incredible dictatorship, new, totally new. But the other one, being irrelevant, they're going to be, they're happy to be like that. They're you know, like people who eat too much. They're fat and they lay and they sleep. All those young people, they're sleepy society. You know, now the most conformist, they dress like non-conformist.
Okay.
Yeah. The most revolutionary, they look like revolutionary.
Yeah.
They feel like revolution, but they don't do nothing. Yeah. Totally irrelevant.
Yeah.
Everything watching a TikTok.
Yeah.
The biggest dictatorial item I know for young people.
Yeah.
Totally stupid. That's how it is.
Well, you know, there's
a big virus.
You're saying exactly what I'm saying, telling my kids every day. You know, they're going to be consumers that think exactly what someone else tells them to think. But you try to change that with Fabrica. You wanted to get young people to produce different things.
Very lazy. Very lazy. Okay. That's the thing. We are lazy. Lazy because it's comfortable not to be subversive. To be subversive, you have to have energy. You know, to be subversive, not revolutionary, subversive. Yeah. You have to have energy. You have to have spirit. You have to be courageous.
Well, you have to know what it means to be subversive. Many people don't know. As you said, they're tricked. They think that dressing up or doing something, that's it. In fact, they're not. And they think that, you know, they're confusing.
Tattoos, they think they're subversive, to make a tattoo. That's it. That's enough.
Yeah. It's very hard to know what is the right thing to do, which is what is the change, because it's all fake. You know, it's very hard to see through the mist, as you said. Yeah. So what do you think? What should I do with my kids? Give me an advice as a parent. Maybe that's the best advice.
Once when I had kids, I had six kids. Okay. But now I got 16 grandchildren.
Whoa.
When I had my kids, there was no television at all.
Yeah.
At all. Not TV. But now I wouldn't do the same. Now, as soon as they get born, I will put a phone in their hand. They immediately have to know what that is. I would make them indigestion. Do you understand?
Yeah.
To the point that they say, all this is bullshit.
Yeah.
It's not a question of fake news. Fake news has always been fake news. The Bible is a fake news. The Vangeli is a fake news. All religions are fake news. Okay? This is not the point. The point is that you don't have to become a collaborationist. You understand collaborationist? That's it.
Yeah, yeah.
You have to question all the time. You have to watch, you have to look, to watch, to analyze, and to criticize everything. You have to have the sense of criticism constantly. You have to be a pain in the ass.
Okay. You know, it's difficult with kids. I agree with you. You know, they have to be very cynical. Let's say cynical is a bad word, but very, as you say, critical. But I'm trying to do that with my kids. But
be critical. They have to understand themselves that they cannot be dependent of that.
But I like that you're saying that we need to shove it on them so they get sick of it.
Yeah.
They need to experience it immediately instead of keeping it away.
No, don't. Let them do. They look 4 hours a day, they have to look 12 hours a day.
Let me get my son, he's gonna like that.
12 hours a day, good. And don't stop, huh? 12 hours, and tomorrow, 16.
I like that, it makes sense. So they get super sick of it and they know everything about it and they're critical. Yeah. That's good. Well, the last question, do you have any questions for me? That's what I usually ask people at the end.
I don't know, there are thousands of questions. I think that, I know how to do it, but I don't know what to do.
So are you asking me what you should do?
No, yes, it. I don't know. I know how to do it, but I don't know what to do. at this moment.
Okay. And, okay. Is that a question for me or?
Now what about you?
Okay. Do I have a question? Am I confused? I know what to do, but I don't know how to do it. The opposite. I know what to do. It's very easy for me to know what to do, but I don't know how to enter the establishment as you did. I think I'm too much of a pissed off person deep inside. I think I need to learn from you. What I want to learn from you is how did you enter inside and make the change from inside? And I was close to that, and I was there.
Well, but you don't do things alone. You have to find an intelligent entrepreneur or somebody, because you work for the system. You don't work, do you understand? What you do? What you got in an advertising agency? What you do?
Well, I'm trying to make let's say social media for innovation. I'm trying to make innovation an open thing, like open source.
You working for the power.
Yeah. Yeah. From inside. Yeah.
You working for the power.
Exactly.
You have to find somebody in the power who is intelligent enough for you, that has got the right intelligent for which you can work for. Okay. You are we are serving somebody, and has to have the right intelligence. And the first thing you have to do, you have to try to enrich his intelligence. That's your work. If you got, let's call him the client, okay? If you got a stupid client, you will do stupid work. Mm-hmm. Probably you do it just because they give you money, but that will ruin you with the time. You can do good work just for good client. Otherwise, forget. And there are very few, but there are. They also are looking for intelligent cooperative people. You know, that's how it is.
I agree. Thank you, Oliviero.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Have a great day. Have a great week, month, year, everything.
16 hour a day is on the social, okay, yeah. Your son. Let's do it. From 6 o'clock in the morning.
From today.
From 6 o'clock, they have to wake up at 5 o'clock and start.
We do with a phone like this.
At 5 o'clock, huh?
I'll try it. I'll
let me. Yeah. They have to start at 5 until 8 o'clock in the evening, non stop.
No, it makes sense. I mean, it really does.
Try it 1 week, you'll see.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Ciao.
Ciao, bye.